Hello, welcome to this lecture. In the last lecture, we talked about energy and enthalpy, and we said that by doing an experiment, we can measure force versus distance, and from that we can compute energy. This is something that we discussed in the last lecture, and we said that energy is half kx square and enthalpy can be also computed. So we said the difference between energy and enthalpy, we said the energy is a function of x, that is you measure the energy for a given extension. At the same time, you could measure the energy for a given force or pressure. Instead of F, it could be pressure. So for a given pressure or given force, you measure the energy, that will be enthalpy. This is something that we discussed, and we said the relation between those two. But we started with an experiment, and we talked about a spring-like protein. But today, let's extend this idea to other interaction energies, something which is very familiar to all of you. Like if you zoom in a little bit more, instead of a protein, if you zoom in a bond, so you have two molecules bonded, right? So you have a bond, two molecules, they are bonded, and then you can pull them, for example, you can imagine pulling them and then measuring the same way, and then you will get some interaction energy. So I can plot interaction energy versus x by computing force and following the same procedure that we did exactly for example, right? And then what would you imagine getting? Like two molecules are interacting. If I pull them apart, what will I find? I will find some force. Initially, it will be difficult to break the bond, right? So I will start pulling. So the energy will increase, and after some time, the bond could break. Once the bonds are broken, then there is no energy. They are free to move anywhere. So then the kind of energy could become a constant. So there is no more change in energy. So you could get such a relation. So this is kind of a constant here. So I would call this energy as some E max, or let me call this E zero itself. And we could set this to zero, because we said in the last lecture that there is a constant unknown which we are free to fix. So I am going to fix that E0 as the constant, which is 0. And this is the minimum energy, right? So this is the minimum of the energy. So let me call it EM. So if you imagine a bond on this side, as you pull, as the X increases, you would have an energy increasing, and after some time, the energy will not change because the bond is broken. So if you can imagine this, there is a spring between the centers of these two atoms or molecule, and as you pull, after some time the energy would be independent of the distance, because wherever you go the same energy, which means there is no interaction between them, and therefore the energy is zero. So this is some negative value. So this is my zero. So this is of course the negative value they are attracting, and you have some negative energy here, which I would call EM. And there is a distance where the bond would break. This distance, let me call it XC, some cutoff distance beyond which the bond is broken. So such a energy you can imagine for formation of bonds. This could be a generic energy for like DNA protein-protein interaction, or any kind of bonding, right? DNA, protein, whatever. So, but this is a simplified version of that energy. One could imagine energy like this. What happens the other way? Like, so if these two proteins or these two molecules, if they come closer, can they come closer? So beyond some point, they cannot come closer because they will start touching each other, and then they would be, there is a steric hindrance, right? So this, there is a steric hindrance, and because of that, beyond some point, the energy will become infinity. You will not be able to close. So this part, so this is the point where they actually kind of equilibrium distance of the bond distance. So I would call this x0, kind of equilibrium distance. And beyond some point, you will not be able to go, the energy will become infinity as you come closer and closer. So this kind of a shape one could imagine for energy of some kind of a bonding interaction, right? So what are the features here? There is a minimum, which is kind of a bond is kind of stable there, and as you go away, as you pull, the energy increases. So that means force also, the derivative of this is force, so negative derivative. So there is a, I can take the slope everywhere, and the negative slope of this is the force. So I have a force here, and after that the force becomes zero. Here the derivative is zero, so the derivative is zero there, that means force is zero. So you have an increasing force and then you have zero force. So this could be an exercise for you to plot the force corresponding to this as a function of x, right? And if they come close and together, they cannot come beyond some point, they cannot come close, so the energy would reach infinity. If they are hard objects, for example, if you imagine two objects like this and they are hard objects, they cannot come closer than this distance, then I need kind of infinite energy to push them through this. They are sterically repelling each other. In such cases, I could redraw this. So in this case, there is infinite energy to go beyond something like this. I would draw. So here I should redraw this a little bit carefully. So here there is an infinite energy beyond, it cannot come. So what is this here? So here, this is the distance, and it can come up to some distance x naught, which is actually the distance between, x naught is the distance between the centers of these objects, right? The center hole here, and this distance is x naught. And if it comes below x naught, the energy is infinity. It cannot come. You need infinite energy to bring it any closer than this. On the other hand, if there is some attraction, you can slowly pull them apart if they are interacting with each other. So if they were interacting with each other, I can slowly pull them apart, and then there is an attraction, and beyond which, after some time, there is no attraction, there is no interaction, they are independent of each other, then the force is zero. So this is another way of representing the same thing. So these are the two, I just drew from experiments. I didn't write any mathematical form, but I can write some simple mathematical form for this. So let me try writing a simple mathematical form for this. For example, I could write here, in the above case, what could I write? I could say that energy is equal to half kx minus x naught whole square. So I would just rewrite this here. I would rub this and write the energy for this here. So let me write the energy for this here. We can have a mathematical form, and the mathematical form could be the following. So E as a function of x is half k into x minus x naught whole square. So this is the spring energy if up to xc. So here you have an half kx square up to xc. So when x is less than xc, this and beyond xc, this would become zero. So equal to the energy is equal to zero when x is when x is greater than xc. So this is a way of writing this mathematically in two parts. People often use this kind of energy when people simulate two particles, two proteins, two constituents, whatever, be it in chemistry, physics and biology. So this is a simple way of having a bond, the energy for bonding, right? If you take kind of neutral atoms or neutral molecules, there is an interesting way of representing energy, which I am going to mention now. So this is a very famous interaction energy. Which is called Lennard-Jones energy, right? Or potential or energy. They have so there is also a name of a person, right? Scientist Lennard-Jones. And this is also called sometimes 6-12 potential. Let me plot that first. So the plot of this is basically, if I just plot energy versus x, the plot looks like this. So it should be smoothly reaching zero as r goes to infinity. So this is the form. What is it? As we just said, there is a minimum. So let me call this minimum value as xm. We called it x0, so we could call it x0 as well. But since it is minimum, let me call it xm. And here, of course, as it goes to infinity, it reaches zero, slowly it reaches zero. So it's parallel to the x-axis here, because it reaches zero only at infinity. And beyond this xm, below this, this is going to infinity. So the slope here, right now is a positive slope. So negative, if I just say my force, if I define force as minus dE by dx, dE by dx is positive and this negative sign would make it negative, that means an attractive force. So this will be an attractive force here, and here the slope is negative, dE by dx, the derivative of this would be negative, and you with this negative sign, this would be a repulsive force. So you have a repulsive part and an attractive part, just like we saw in the previous case. So this again represents two neutral atoms or molecules, where x is the distance between these two centers. So it is not hard objects, they are kind of soft, which means that it can come a little bit below the xm, still the energy is kind of finite, and beyond some point it becomes very, very, very large. So the mathematical formula for this is, this energy is the following. So E is equal to some epsilon. So epsilon is basically this point. So this energy value is epsilon, whatever. This could be like 2 kBTR or 3 kilocal per mole. You could have some value for this minimum. So this energy at the minimum is epsilon. Epsilon times some constant. So in general, so in this particular case, let me write here, this would be xm by x whole power 12 minus 2 times xm by x whole power 6. This is a standard way of writing. So xm is this point and x is the function. In general, I could write this as a by x power 12 minus b by x power 6.
It has two parameters a and b. Here also two parameters epsilon and xm. Both are equivalent. You can compare these two and find out what is a and what is b. How does a and b are related to epsilon and xm. So this is a way of precisely writing in a meaningful way where xm is this particular point of minimum and epsilon is this energy value. But in general you could write this way, ax power 12 minus bx power 6. So because of this power you can, this also has this name 612 potential. Now as I said, it has this feature that it is repulsive part and an attractive part. So this attractive part, which is this beyond this point, this part is the attractive part. This attractive part is also called the van der Waal force, right? So this attractive part, which is this part, is called the van der Waal force. So it is van der Waal, double AL. So this is the van der Waal force, this attractive part. This is basically coming from the fact that if you have kind of a fluctuating dipole, right, you have a, you can think of two charges, a plus nucleus and electron around it, kind of a cloud of electron. So you have two nuclei and some cloud of electron around it. It doesn't have a very specific location, right? It's a cloud of electron. And because of that, these dipoles actually give us this instantaneous dipoles, actually give this this power x power 6. That's how this, that is the origin of this x power 6. So x power 12 has more complicated origins and it is not unique. You could have various numbers there, but this is the typical potential used for interacting objects. There's a weak attraction and there is a strong repulsion. This is often used. If you have neutral objects, which doesn't, if you want to neglect the van der Waal's interaction, you could just have only up to this and zero beyond this. You could say that this is zero beyond this and the energy is only up to this. That's also often used. So in the case of the van der Waal's interaction, or in the case of Lennard-Jones potential that we wrote, this number, this parameter is very important. There are two parameters, as we said. One is this epsilon parameter and the other one is the xm parameter. Xm decides the location, the x at which you have the minimum, and epsilon decides the depth of the minimum. So this depth of the minimum is basically the strength of the bond. So if I spend this much energy, I can break the bond, or the energy could be zero. So these two parameters are important, and it's important to remember epsilon. Roughly, I would call this like the strength of the bond, the interaction strength, strength of the interaction. I would also call this roughly energy needed to break the bond. So let me write energy to break the bond. So these are the two parameters that we should remember as far as this particular interaction is concerned. Okay, so now we have discussed this and you have understood this, we will go to the next step, which is basically we can think of bonds as some kind of vectors. So these are two amino acids, and they are bonded, they have some bond here. And now you have to worry about the angle here. Which angle would they take? What would be their orientation? So if you want to think about energy in such cases, and this is the next step, so energy of interaction, what orientation would it take? So let us say, would it be straight, or would it be bent like this, or would it be bent like this, right? So typically what happens is that every bonds will have some preferred angle. They would be like to be like this or like this. So we would tell a simple model for that. So a simple model is, if you have two bonds, two vectors, so let us say, so let me just quickly write that two cases here. So to think about two bonds, let's draw two vectors. So I'll have a vector like this and another vector which has a different direction. So then there is an angle between these two vectors. So this angle is this, some angle theta. Or I could have a vector like this and another vector like this, and you could have an angle theta between these two vectors. So if you have two bonds like this with an angle, and if the bond angle should be zero, then the interaction energy, so the interaction energy then can be written as, so this is the interaction energy in this particular case, I would call it bending energy, is some bending constant KB times 1 minus cos of this angle theta, cos theta. So this is a way of writing the energy. What does that mean? This means that if theta is 0, cos 0 is 1, so then the energy is 0. So if those two are in this particular case, the way we wrote, if they are straight, the energy is 0. If you bend a little bit, then cos theta will have some value which is less, between 0 and 1. And because of that, 1 minus, and there will be some number which is less than 1. So there will be a positive number and there would be some energy. Right? So we can plot this and check how would this look like. So if I just plot cos theta between minus pi to pi, this would look like this here and like this here, like symmetric, right? I should be symmetric. And 1 minus cos theta would be the other way. So if I just draw 1 minus cos theta, so 1 minus cos theta would look like an x square with a minimum here. So I should redraw this a little bit. So yeah, so something like this, symmetric again. So this is 1 minus cos theta. It looks like an x square because one can expand cos theta in the infinite series. This is infinite series of cos theta and sin theta is something, this is a famous discovery from India. So you can expand this infinite series, and then you would see that 1 minus cos theta can be written as 1 minus theta square by 2 plus dot dot dot. If I use that, I would get this as theta square by 2. So you would get, again, this is approximately theta square by 2. That's why for small theta, this is theta square by 2 plus, that's why it looks like half kx square, same way. So the energy is kb into 1 minus cos theta. This is approximately kb into theta square by 2 plus some higher order term. So approximately this is this for small values of theta. This can be approximated to kb theta square by 2. So this is the typical bending energy. Now one could have, instead of here the energy is minimum if they are straight, but they need not be straight, they can have a angle. So in that time, this, if they have a preferred angle, so let us say it prefers some angle theta 0, let us say 30 degree or 20 degree, it prefers some angle, in that case this energy would be replaced by, so there is a preferred, if there is a preferred angle, this would be KB times 1 minus cos theta minus theta 0. So this would be the energy. This would be exactly like this but shifted. So when theta is theta 0, it will have minimum energy, and any deviation from theta 0 will cause some energy. So these are the ways of writing interaction energies, and there are some reason for these which I wouldn't go into the details now, but at some point we would try to understand these details, and we would explain why these energies are the way they are. So we will stop here and we will continue in the next class.